Thanks for joining us for today's episode of The Capitalist Investor. I am back after like a two-week hiatus. I got Derek and Luke with me.
What's up, man?
Feels glad good to be back in the seat, you know?
We're glad to have you back, man.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's always 10 times more energy, you know, when you're here.
I try, man. I try. I'm sure you guys did just fine without me. Of course, I didn't listen to the podcast.
two weeks ago, it was just me and Luke just ripping on you the whole time.
Nice.
I thought 2 weeks ago was real good.
That was a good episode.
Yeah, I liked that one. That was good energy.
Yeah, don't watch the episode. All
right. Oh, man. All right, so look, we got three major things we want to talk about today. So first one was actually a question we got. How did we get this, Luke?
On your Twitter, yeah. Someone responded to one of your tweets and asked this question.
So this revolves around... How do you know when to take profits when you have large gains?
That's a great question, and we get that a lot, actually.
Yeah, so we'll hit on that. Then we're going to talk about the housing market. Big, big changes happening in the housing market right now. The 10-year mortgage, average 10-year mortgage on January 1st was around 3.2%. At the time we're recording this episode, it's up to about 4%. And it's only going higher. Mm-hmm. So we need to talk about the impact that that's going to have on the housing market, on lower income people, middle income people, high income people who probably don't care because their multi-million dollar investment accounts are up substantially, up 50% over the last 2 years.
Yep.
But we need to talk about everyone else, Main Street, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And then the third thing is mask mandates. Finally being lifted.
I never thought...
Until they come back.
I hope to God
not. They better not come back.
But I never thought this...
coming back.
I never thought this day would come, though. You know, with Cali lifting some of these things. We'll talk about that then, but... Or when we get to that topic.
The fact that Cali beat New York is interesting.
It is.
You know, New York, I just lifted their mask mandate today. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if that applies to New York City.
Well, isn't their big thing with the Super Bowl coming up? Isn't it in Cali, right?
If I'm they kind of had to do
yeah.
that, right? Or else they were gonna.
So I'm pretty sure that's Super Bowl. I'm pretty sure that's why, because like they're gonna lose all that business, and obviously Super Bowl is like the most watched event, and tickets are selling for what, $6,000 a pop or something for the lowest.
How do you even know
the get-in
price? You guys checking them out?
I'm pretty sure we talked about it last week.
Yeah. Oh man! All right, so let's start at the top. Let's take the first topic first. Taking profits when you have large gains, how do you make that decision? So I think the first thing that we need to consider is, where are these gains? Are they in an IRA or 401k where there's absolutely no tax consequence to unwinding these positions? Or are they in non-qualified accounts, which are fully taxable accounts where if you did sell them, you have to pay a capital gains tax, whether it be a short-term capital gains tax, which is really high. It's taxed at your income tax rate. Or if it's the more beneficial long-term capital gains tax rate, right?
Yep.
So where do you guys want to start with this one?
You know, I think what you just said there has sparked something in my mind. So yeah, absolutely. And we talk about this in some of the educational classes that we do. Understanding taxes is a really important part to investing. So some people listening to this may not know. But what Mark just said there is crucially important to understand. So if you're saving into your work plan, your 401k, 403b, if you have a traditional IRA, you know, you don't really need to worry about taxes until you start taking that money out in retirement, right? Because you can buy and sell in there, and there's no tax consequences. So I think this question came from a non-qualified plan, so a taxable, you know, investment account. And that, if you're investing in there, if you're saving in there, understanding taxes in that account is crucial to your gains.
It's all about after-tax returns.
Yeah, absolutely.
You should never, anytime you're looking at the returns in your taxable account or non-qualified, we're going to use those terms interchangeably.
Mm-hmm.
Anytime you're looking at your returns, you always have to subtract out the portion of that return that really goes to tax.
Yep.
You know? And I think if you do that every single year as you're kind of calculating your returns, it's going to blindside you a heck of a lot less.
Yeah.
When it comes time for you to sell, right? Hey, I was up 20% last year. But that's really only 15% by the time I unwind. Exactly. So, you know, like yep. if you start yep. to think like that.
And then you even got to put in inflation on top of that. And I don't want to get into that.
Oh,
but I'm
yeah.
just saying,
we're talking
that's,
real returns. Yeah.
Yeah. But I'm saying if we're talking real returns, there's other variables as well you got to include. So, yeah. so that's why, and that leads into kind of my thought is, you know, this question changes every single year or every 4 years, whatever it be, whenever tax laws change, right? Because our answer now could be completely different than 10 years from now. I mean, it's some similar synergies, but right now we're kind of in a really low tax rate environment, like when it comes to capital gains tax and even ordinary income tax, like the big jump from 12% to 22%. But even then, we're historically pretty low, right? So that's something to consider is right now, if you've got a $200,000, you know, long-term gain or even short-term gain, yeah, you're going to pay some taxes on that. But would you rather let that maybe grow even more 5 years down the road because we have Biden in there and
yeah.
and some more, you know, left-wing policy probably coming about?
Yeah.
And then pay even more tax down the road on a larger gain? That's a question you got to answer. So that's one thing you always have to factor in.
I agree. So I've got, I think, three rules as it relates to looking at your highly appreciated position. So the first rule, I already mentioned it, right? Which is always look at your after-tax returns, right? Number two, I want to play with the house's money as much as I possibly can,
mm-hmm.
right? So, I mean, if I put, you know, 20,000 bucks into an investment and it grows to 100, if I can get my 20 grand back, I'm comfortable letting that 80 grand ride for a heck of a lot longer. Number three, never, ever, ever let the tax tail wag the dog. That's where you start to run into trouble.
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, well, you know, hey, this stock sucks, but I don't want to sell it because there's, you know, I'd have to pay a capital gains tax on it. Which, when you do that, you're incurring a different cost, which is opportunity cost.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Because you could have unwound that position and repositioned the money somewhere else. And possibly made a heck of a lot more money over the course of the next 5 to 10 years.
I don't know about you, Mark, but I like to win. And paying tax on a gain is a consequence of winning.
Absolutely. And I think
if you're not paying tax, you're
yeah.
losing.
You're losing money.
Investment.
Yeah.
Yeah. A great way to pay less in taxes is just make a bunch of bad investments in your non-qualified account and get $3,000 off your tax bill every year. But one of the things that came to mind for me in my personal investment life was Facebook, now Meta, I guess is what they call it. So, you know, I got in Facebook almost at the low. I think it was around $20. It was in a non-qualified account.
Yeah.
And it obviously blew up, you know, that. And that was great. But how I dealt with that over time was exactly what Mark just said, playing with house money.
Yep.
So if I bought that stock for 20 and it blows up to 200, I have a couple choices. But what I did, instead of just holding on to that forever and gifting it to my children when I die, you know, I'm going to take a little chunk at a time. You know, I was selling, you know, basically one share at a time. And repositioning that into something else. So Facebook, just like every other company, isn't going to be on a trajectory straight up forever.
Yeah.
Right? So we need to take that profit and put it somewhere else. And that's what I did. So you always have to be conscious of not getting overly attached to your positions. And we talk about this a lot, too, in our classes. Behavioral finance, you know, when you have a winner like that, you're just going to want to hang on to it forever. It's kind of a natural thing.
Yeah.
And you're not going to want to pay taxes. That is a natural thing yeah, as well.
Right.
You don't want to just send
give any
send
dollar
that money
to
the government, right? So
yeah.
Those are natural feelings to have, but you have to work against them, reposition those assets into the next Facebook, right? Now you have free chances to find that next stock.
Well, especially if you're like very concentrated in like one single stock or one security, like obviously that's a heavy concentration risk and you could lose 50% of your money tomorrow and, yeah. and then you wiped out your entire position or entire gain possibly, right? If it's in something maybe like a diversified fund or NASDAQ or, you know, S&P, it's a little bit different. It's yeah. a little bit of a different question. Mm-hmm. But that's why this thing's so complicated. There's no one direct answer because everyone's situation is so much different.
Yep.
There's so many different moving parts. Like I know, for example, you know, for one of our current clients, we use like an opportunity fund to reduce their taxable, you know, income because they had a huge, huge gain, and that really helped them out, saved them a ton in taxes. So there's other things out there to reduce your taxes as well, is all I'm saying.
Yeah, and you could also, I mean, I doubt you can do this on Robinhood, but you should be able to select the highest cost basis shares when you want to sell to reduce your tax bill.
Mm-hmm.
I bet you if you're selling on Robinhood, they don't care. I have no idea what rule they follow, you know, but I mean, if you're working with a real investment firm, you should be able to select the shares that are being sold.
Right.
And you can kind of hold on to the lowest cost base of shares as your legacy position, right? Mm-hmm. And hold those for a long time and eventually pass them down to your beneficiary so they get the step up in basis, assuming that rule doesn't change, which it probably will.
Probably will.
All right, let's move on to the next topic, which is the housing market. So I kind of teed this one up by saying that mortgage rates have gone from 3.2 to 4% over the course of 40 days, give or take. That's a big move.
Yeah.
Right. And I think 12 months from today, they could be at 5%, right? I think that's very possible, given what the Fed is looking to do, given where the 10-year treasury could be headed. I think that's a very, very realistic possibility.
Absolutely.
And when you look at, I mean, the housing market over the course of the last few years, it had like a perfect confluence of events happening, right? You had low inventory, you had a lot of buyers, you had low interest rates. Everyone was getting big stimmy checks, which they used for their down payment. Like it was just the perfect storm for the housing market to erupt. And I believe from the prior peak in 2019 to where we are now, if I look at the average home price today, it's probably about 20% higher, which actually seems low to me.
Yeah.
When I did my research on this, I thought it was probably up more like 33%.
Yeah.
Yep.
It was only up like 20-ish percent.
Right.
Now
the question is moving forward, where do we go, right?
That's always a question. Who cares about what happened, right? Who cares?
And you mentioned that, you know, the interest rates rising from roughly 3% up to 4%, right? That's almost a 1% increase. And what's very interesting to me is a 1% increase on a 30-year mortgage equates to about $50,000 to $60,000 of extra cost of interest over time.
And you're
right?
Using what, a $300,000 mortgage?
I'm using a $300,000 mortgage.
Yep,
that's exactly
so
right.
So I mean the average value of a home right now in the US I think is $375.
Yep.
That makes sense, you know, 20%
and that's
down,
like $200
right?
in extra payments per month. I mean that adds up, man.
Yeah, I
mean,
so I just did the math, right? I think it's like between January 1st to right now, your mortgage payment, assuming you have, you know, the 4% rate now versus 3.2, it's up like 10-11% from where it would have been January 1st. If we go to 5%, from 4 to 5, it's going to go up another 12%. Like, that's crazy. That's like a 25-ish percent increase over the course of maybe 15 months, if you think about it.
Yep. Now the question is, are housing prices going to decline with the interest rates rising even further, right? I mean, that's kind of the thought process. Interest rates rise, demand falls, and then the prices of homes fall. So, I mean, that's the big
question. I think you're definitely going to see fewer home buyers. I mean, if you look at Cleveland, where we're at, you have an open house on a Saturday. By Sunday, all the offers are due. Monday, you make your decision. You've got 20 offers, right? Yep. Like it's absolutely crazy. I think those 20 offers go down to 10 over the course of the next few months. And then a few months after that, those 10 go down to 5. And you start to get back to a normalization of the housing market. You start to go back to trend.
A big thing that's the majority that's being impacted here are the first time home buyers, right? Because if you already had a home and you appreciated 30%, like you might not be able to upgrade because the higher, you know, higher priced homes are going to go up as well. But like, still, it's not going to like be detrimental because, you know, a lot of, you know, a middle class net worth is tied into their home.
Yep.
Luke, why don't you go through these final 2 points? Because I thought these were fantastic here.
So there was a study out there that calculated the affordability of homes, and it's focusing on the middle class on 30-year fixed rate mortgages. And they're assuming that 30% of people or 30% of income for the middle class is going towards housing costs, with including taxes and insurance. What they found was that the affordability obviously worsened over the past 2 years for all, but the very wealthiest Americans and the shrinking number of homes on the market made home buying more difficult actually in every income bracket. So not even just the lower class and the middle class, but also the wealthy. So that was very interesting, a very interesting point. I mean, obviously we talked about, you know, the COVID-19 pandemic, you know, turbocharging everything going on in the market. But now the question is do you sell your home and go to another home, or do you sell your home, go in an apartment, try to time the market? That's the big question. That's another big question.
That's where I was headed with it. So, you know, even those people, and, you know, say your home was worth $1 million, right? So you're in the highest bracket before in 2019, and now you can sell it for $1.4 million, right? And that's awesome. But now you have to go buy another home.
Yep.
At a much higher interest rate. So who's going, you know, you have to be.
It doesn't make sense if you're moving up.
Yeah, it definitely does not.
If you're downsizing, it could make a lot of sense to do that right now.
Yep. So, and actually, real quick about the Cleveland market, because one of my clients just sold their house, actually. And they got, I believe, 5 offers in the first day after the first open house.
Yeah.
And interesting enough, the buyer that they selected was from Seattle.
Really?
Yeah. So, and I've heard that a couple other
places. Like just using it as an investment, or are they moving?
No, they're moving.
Oh, so they're getting out of the
Antifa.
Yeah. The Antifa zone. What do they call that?
The Chad. Was it Chad?
Chaz. I don't know. Something
Chaz.
Like that.
Yeah, Chaz. Yeah, it was Chaz. Yep. Yeah. So yeah, I found that extremely interesting too. So, you know, there's all kinds of shifts going on in this country that we've just never seen before. You know, people moving back to the Midwest, you know, it just doesn't usually happen. The people are trying to.
Heck, I'm waiting for the day to move down south or out west somewhere. Like, I'm absolutely. Like, get me out of the Midwest.
You know what? So, man, I've always wanted to live in California, like Newport Beach. That's my spot. Mm-hmm. Now, I haven't been there since 2019. Mm-hmm. I refuse to go to what that state has turned into.
Country. Right. It's another country.
Yeah, it really is. But I was talking with Nate about this a couple weeks ago, and the time difference is too substantial to move west. It really is. I mean, like Rob Luna, one of the guys that does Fox Business, that dude's out in, I think, L.A. maybe, and he filled in for me on Mornings with Maria last week, which starts at 3 a.m. his time, 6 a.m. our time. Like, dude, that's a big, big difference. I couldn't do that. I could move south, but I can't move west into a different time zone.
Yep.
I mean, then the market opens at 6:30 a.m. Like, I'm not saying it's good to wake up early, but like, still, it's like you got to be sharp.
So much for the morning workout when the market opens at 6:30 a.m.
3 a.m. workout.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah. It's a little brutal. All right, a couple key things I want to mention here before we move on. So the first thing is, and you guys kind of touched on it already, but who does this really hurt the most? And the person this hurts the most is the person that Joe Biden is supposed to be fighting for.
Yep. Absolutely.
Lower income people, middle America, those people who are living kind of paycheck to paycheck. The uber rich who've got a $10 million investment account, that's up from $7 million 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. They could cut a check from their gains and buy a vacation home. They don't care.
Yeah. Right.
Doesn't bug them. Who this really hurts is those people who are living paycheck to paycheck who may have a meager investment account. And by meager, less than $1 million, I guess I'll say. Like, I mean, if you have less than $1 million, this hurts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you have over $1 million, it's, you know, you're a little better off because you've experienced some pretty substantial gains in your account. But, you know, under $1 million, under $500,000, under $250,000 is probably where it hurts the most. Yep. In investments, right? And what percentage of the people in our country have less than $250,000 in investments? I'm just going to make a number up. Mm-hmm. It's got to be 95 plus percent.
Yep. I was going to say 90.
I was going to say 92. Yeah,
it's got to be. Mm-hmm. Right? It hurts all of those people. Hurts them. Second thing I want to comment on is which industries are impacted by there being fewer home buyers?
A lot.
You would immediately think like the dead giveaways, which are home builders, contractors. Okay. Obviously. Mm-hmm. Right. But look at that. Look at the spider web of what industries this would impact. Like when you move into a house, you buy new furniture. So all the furniture stores, manufacturers, they get hurt. You buy new appliances, appliance manufacturers, you know, the stores that sell them, they all get hurt. Computer chips go into those appliances nowadays.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That goes down. Like there's the spider web impact is huge.
Yep.
So if the housing market cools right now, I think the housing market's only like 5% of GDP. But then you look at all the derivative industries that are impacted, and sure, it's much far-reaching than just 5% of GDP.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So, yeah, you know, to put a bow on it, as they say, that was what Mark just said was my key takeaway of all this. That's why I, you know, Luke found this great study. It's just crushing the first-time home buyers. You know, I know it's going through everything, but that – I don't understand why people can't see that.
Like, yeah,
it's really obvious, and this group of people, that is who is going to prop up the economy going forward, and then they're getting priced out of the home market, the first time home buyers. So I just don't understand why, you know, someone who says that they're here to support those people, and when they clearly don't do that, why they're not called out for that?
Yeah. No, absolutely. Yeah. I heard Mark say Joe Biden. He didn't say President Joe Biden. I'm getting a ton of flack right now on Twitter.
Are you serious?
Not a ton of flack. I got a couple people coming at me hard and like, you didn't say President Joe Biden.
I'll tell you, I try to be respectful of the guy. I try to call him President Biden. I don't do it all the time, but I try to be respectful. He is the president. He's not mentally fit to be president, but he is the president.
Yeah,
you know, regardless.
I find it interesting right now. I'm getting haters coming out.
Well, dude, I mean, there's always haters. I think I posted this on Twitter a couple weeks ago, but I find it very, very flattering when someone creates a fake Twitter account just to mess with me.
Yeah, you've got
just to
lot,
pick a fight.
Man.
Like I'll go and I'll check out. They got no followers.
Yep.
They follow like 10 people, of which I'm one of them. And they have no tweets, but you look at all of their like replies and they're all of my tweets.
Yep.
It's like, man, this account was created just to fight with me.
Yeah.
Yep.
They're very nice of you.
I got my first like fake profile 2 months ago. I'm like, I finally made it, guys.
Yeah. Oh yeah. 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 That's a different animal.
You gotta watch out for those too.
Yeah. All right. Let's move on to mask mandates. Who wants to tee this one up?
I mean, Luke put all these together, but this started with me because I just want to go on a cruise.
Do you like cruises?
Yeah, I do.
Now we got to have a side conversation.
Best vacation.
You like cruises too?
I am planning one for. I was planning for one for April, but
I'm not a big fan.
So the Disney cruise with young kids, I think, is pretty awesome.
It is cool
because you get all. So my kids are, you know, they'll be 3 and 5 this summer, so they're 2 and 4 right now. So they're too young for the park. Me and my daughter is into it, but they're not going to go on the rides. They're not going to go on Tower of Terror and everything. They're mainly interested in the characters. So the Disney cruise kind of gives everyone the best of all worlds. So it's Disney themed. There's lots of Disney stuff, but there's still good stuff for the adults. You know, they always have great food on that ship. And then you get to, you know, if you want to go off, this is pre-COVID, but if you want to get off the boat, you can do all the different stops and there's fun activities to do. That's different than Disney World, but the kids still love it.
Yep. See, cruises in general, though, they just have everything you could ever want on the ship and off
except
the ship.
Except for a pool that's big enough for you to get into.
Well, I don't know.
The pools are tiny. You don't go in the pool?
I mean, I do, but... it's still pretty big. It's got like 4 pools, 5 pools.
Well,
so if you got one that's full, you go to an. I mean, I guess that
really?
Being said.
See, I feel like they're very small given the number of people that are on the ship.
Oh yeah,
very small.
Mm-hmm.
Very small.
If it's the main problem with the cruise is when you're at sea and everyone's at that pool.
Yep.
That's definitely the main problem. Yep.
But you've got,
and that's typically the first 2 days.
Yep.
But you've got all you can eat food and good food. And then you also got the comedy clubs, you got the casino. I mean,
the Disney cruise, have you done the Disney cruise, Dee?
Mm-hmm.
That is excellent food.
Yep.
By far the best food I've ever had at an all-inclusive kind of, because I think we did upgrade to the all-inclusive food package, but normally all-inclusive food sucks, in my opinion.
No, so I go through Carnival, and you know, you have your like fancy dinners that like are like you actually have a server and everything, but for like lunch and stuff, you got to go up to the different buffets. But even then, they're like phenomenal,
pretty good.
Like it's like different cultures and stuff, like food from all around the world. But anyway, we're getting off topic.
Back on track. Mask mandates.
So I've been tracking. So in 2019, I think that's when I went on my first Disney cruise, and they were talking about building the new ships. And I want to say that 2021 was when they were supposed to launch, and here we are at the start of 2022, and they've gotten delayed again, this time, I guess, by construction delays in Germany.
Yeah,
what a surprise. Carnival Cruise, and I think a couple other ones too, they're supposed to open up without restrictions, you know, no vaccination cards in April. So
we'll see if that happens.
Yeah, so we will see if that happens. But, you know, with midterm elections coming up, the Democrats are backtracking on everything that they've said over the last year.
Is that a good look for them?
Well, it's obvious what's going on.
They're trying to save face.
It's a clown show, honestly.
Yeah.
When these people stand up and say, you know, Joe Biden has defeated coronavirus. You know, it's comical.
Yeah,
it really is.
I don't know one.
Who's saying that about him?
Nancy Pelosi? No, there was the Attorney General, I think.
Oh, geez.
I just saw a clip.
Yeah, he's done nothing.
Nothing at all. Yeah. so that's the main question, right? If these cruise ships are opening without restriction, then that means COVID is over. So,
right.
Are we moving into that direction? And would you guys go on a cruise again?
Well, so, go ahead.
So we got off of, you know, the cruises as well, but also you got, you know, states that like Connecticut, Delaware, New Jersey, Oregon, California, we talked about. They're lifting the mask mandates. And that's part of reopening America. We are reopened basically, but the whole reopening, getting COVID behind us, is the mask mandates. Like, we got to get rid of these stuff. Like, in Ohio, we don't have any, except when you go to certain things, like schools, I think, still require them and stuff like that, or at least universities.
Yeah.
But cruise ships are on the topic there. Like, they still require masks. Like, once the whole mask mandates get lifted all around, COVID's over, right? Yeah. That's what you would think. So the big question.
Well, they were already all lifted at one point.
Oh, yeah, that's already.
They came back
as soon as
COVID wasn't over.
But
Joe Biden screwed up at Afghanistan. That's when they came off the first time.
Yeah.
But when it's over, are we going to stop talking about it? That's what I'm worried about. Like, we literally.
No.
Like, okay, well, I mean, I think we just. I mean, I don't know, man. Like, I feel like people are going to try to bury this whole thing.
Well, I don't know about that, but what I can tell you is that 70% of Americans are sick and tired of talking about COVID.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a poll, Monmouth poll, I believe, if that's how you pronounce it, January 31st of this year. 70% of Americans say, I've heard enough of COVID. It's here. We need to learn to live with it and move on.
Yeah.
So that's got to tell you something. Like, people are sick and tired of living in fear. It's never going away. It's never, ever going away.
Yeah.
So we have to just learn to live with it. If you want to wear a mask like they do in Asia, even when there's no pandemic in China, a good chunk of the people are walking around with masks. If you want to do that because that's your decision that you want to wear a mask, feel free.
You have every right.
Now, if you're wearing it in the car by yourself, I got problems with that. You shouldn't be doing that.
Well, I mean, they can do it, but I might find them a little
weird.
I mean, they can choose to do whatever they want, their own house and their own car, but I'll judge them for it, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah.
I'll look over and be like, what the hell are you doing?
Definitely judge them. So it's time that we move on, man.
Yeah.
You know, and I think, look, right now, all of the data points are looking like there is going to be a pretty substantial red wave in the midterms, that the Republicans are projected to pick up around 40 seats in the House and take the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
So you just kind of look at the dominoes beginning to fall in all of these blue states. where it's, you know, I don't know who went first of all of these liberal states. Was it California? Did they make the first move to drop the mask mandate?
I think it was because of the Super Bowl. I think
so.
That
was. Yeah, there was a hidden agenda, right, where they wanted to keep the Super Bowl, mm-hmm. so they did it for that reason.
Can't charge people $6,000 a ticket when you have to wear a mask the entire time and everything.
Exactly. And speaking of which, I know Eric Adams, the mayor of New York City, where they did have a mask mandate. I don't know if the state of New York dropping that applies to them or not again, but he was just seen in a restaurant with no mask on.
Oh yeah. Like they break all their AOC. Old rules all the time.
Yeah.
I think AOC
they don't care.
Nope. Out of Florida, they she's don't like care. Living life down there and wasn't obeying her own rules and stuff like that she was trying to push. Like
bad look for that party.
They're all hypocrites.
Yeah.
Best way to describe it.
Yeah, we talked last week about the guy from California who was holding his breath when he took the photo.
Oh my God, dude! Come on!
That's the new COVID tactic. Didn't you see the CDC release that? Holding your breath.
I was holding my breath. It's 100%
effective. I'm just kidding. That's not actually one, but it wouldn't surprise me that was one.
When COVID first surfaced in the U.S., this is my wife and I were coming back from a vacation down in Cancun, January of 2020. And we landed in Chicago to go through customs and everything. And I remember walking past people that were coughing. And in that case, I told my wife, I'm like, hold your breath. Hold your breath as we walk past these people. So we did do that. But I mean, we were walking past people that were coughing.
Yeah.
Man,
I'm just interested to see, you know, when COVID first started, you know, if you were coughing and anywhere, like everyone like literally like went away and like looked back at you like what, you know, you got COVID.
Yeah. Now, God forbid you need to clear your throat.
Right. And I mean, I do that all the time. Like, sorry, that's just, it's natural. Like mm-hmm. sometimes you get something stuck in your throat. Yeah, like it's nothing bad with that. Yeah. Or even sneezing or something. Like you can't stop sneezing.
Yep.
But, you know, I'm interested to see as we come out of this whole thing, and we, you know, if COVID is over finally, you know, or over this year is finally will
COVID
be
over. COVID should be over from a policy standpoint.
The policy standpoint, the politics standpoint. Yes. Like, yeah, COVID's here to stay. It's
correct.
It's the flu. It's going to turn into the flu, hopefully, right? I mean, that's what it is now.
Yeah,
it
keeps getting weaker and
weaker,
hopefully.
Weaker and weaker, and it turns into the common flu. But I mean, it'd be interesting to see if these, I mean, I think it will, if this will have lasting impact on children. With the mask mandates and like seeing how people react to certain situations, even adults, like are people going to be afraid to be in small areas? You know,
why do you think we're talking about the damn metaverse, dude?
Right.
So kids can sit in their basement by themselves and hang out with their buddies. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Elon Musk talked about not having enough kids is like the end of civilization. The metaverse is the end of civilization because you cannot have kids in the metaverse. Like, I don't know how you're supposed to date and have kids in the metaverse.
Yeah. I saw something, I can't remember exactly what it said, but someone was saying like Zuckerberg created the metaverse where you can go and live in this virtual world, or you can just go outside and live in the universe and live in the real world or something like that.
Yeah.
Eat good food and live life. Like, it's just, I don't know. Like,
it's very strange, but look, that all of a sudden, like the attention's on that, and people are trying to justify why the metaverse is going to succeed, why it's going to be the next big thing. I'm looking at it like it seems stupid to me, you know? But there's so many people who believe in it, and I think part of that belief is due to us all being quarantined and locked up and wearing masks where no one can actually see what you look like.
Yeah.
Like, and that's what has happened, because you can go into the metaverse and you can look how you could be at 380 pounds and obese.
Yeah.
And in the metaverse, you could be ripped, shredded.
Six-pack shredded.
Yeah. Right?
I can go eat all the wings I ever wanted in the metaverse.
I know.
But the other part of it is crime that's not talked about much. Even with the mask mandate, I attribute everything that we've done for COVID to this, including mask mandates, including this stuff. Crime's gone up like 20-30% since, like, at least here in Cleveland, it's gone up. And I think all around's gone up 20-30%. And my car just got broken into. I was talking to you about that yesterday. Like,
it's terrible.
I mean, it's horrible, man. Like, I mean, that never happened to me. I feel like that's happening. It's more common now because literally people have gone crazy because of all these things, restrictions, mandates. Humans were not made, or humans were not programmed to be restricted like we have in the past 2 years.
The comment on that, the three of us are going to be fine. Everyone that's listening to this podcast, they're going to be fine too. The people I'm worried about are my kids.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm worried about, and my kids are a little bit older, you know, so their most formative years when they were, like, let's say in kindergarten, they're at least past that.
Yeah.
What
are kids going to be taught about this whole thing, like 10 years from down the road?
But what they're being taught right now is what concerns me, sure, which is you must comply. Do yep. not think for yourself. You must comply. You must wear a mask. Dude, like, teen suicide rates have skyrocketed because of this.
I saw a study, even 18 to 64, deaths are up 30-40%, and it's proven that COVID was not the culprit to that. But what is a culprit is overdoses, suicides. So 30% rise is like a 1 in 200 year event. Like, that it rises 30% year over year.
In like below 20 age group or something?
18 to 64. So all.
Oh, 18, wow.
So yeah, so that whole age group, I didn't look deep enough to figure out what, like, the big spike was, like what age group, but I don't think there was a spike in just one certain age group. It was the whole thing, because suicides, overdoses, like the mental health side of things is
addiction. Addiction's big.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, you were drinking, you know, 3 beers a night pre-COVID. Now you're up to a 12 pack and you're a full blown alcoholic.
Yeah.
Right. Like,
that's concerning, man.
Dude, there are a lot of, you know, we talked about the housing markets and the derivative industries. There are a lot of derivative consequences to what we've gone through the last couple of years. And and I'll be fine. Like, I'm strong-willed. Like, I don't care. Like, I'm done wearing the mask. Yeah. I was on an airplane yesterday. It was on my chin the entire time. You know,
the French fry in your mouth, like that one.
Wait,
guy.
No, you gotta,
I saw someone. She took a picture on LinkedIn. She had her hand in like the M&M bag, and I'm thinking, like, man, they claim that they don't melt in your mouth, not in your hand. That's bullshit.
Right? Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
You pulled your finger out, and you had blue and yellow.
Yeah,
right.
Well, I was just at the Cavs game a week ago, and actually, it's interesting. The Cavs stadium or Rocket Mortgage Fieldhouse still requires masks. It's like one of the only
that's
places.
Ridiculous.
It is ridiculous.
Yep.
But I was walking around the whole time. I had to wear my mask into it, took my mask off. I bought a Miller Lite, held it up to my chin the entire time walking around. I'm not wearing a damn mask.
All right. So that, and then we gotta wrap up. We're way off topic here. But that leads to the next question, which is, which requires more energy on your part, holding the beer up next to your chin for a 2.5 hour long game or just putting the damn mask on?
I will not comply.
All right. So if you're standing your ground, I get it. But me, I looked at the picture on LinkedIn of the girl literally holding her arm in an M&M bag.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's got to be tiring after a while.
Yeah.
Like, you got to get sick and tired of that after a little bit. So, you know, if that's the case, I'll put the mat, but I'm still going to break the rules. It's still going to be on my chin.
Well, it just means I'm drinking my Miller Lite faster. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
get another one.
That's,
you know,
the key on an airplane. I always have a drink next to me. My hand is close to it. Like, they come over, hey, put your mask on. I'm about to have a sip. What are you talking about? You know?
Exactly.
Anything else we want to hit on?
I think we got it.
All right. Thanks for joining us. As always, if you have any questions, hit us up with an email at info@swpconnect.com. We appreciate you. We'll talk to you next week.
The opinions expressed in the podcast are for general informational purposes only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations for any investment, legal, financial, or tax strategy. It is only intended to provide education about the financial industry. Please consult a qualified professional about your individual needs.